Welcome to this, the third lecture in the series of events that to celebrate African American History Month, sponsored by the Department of History, Geography, and Global Studies, now a unit within the larger Department of Humanities, and the Intellectual Life Committee. Today we'll be hearing from Dr. Bankole-Medina, one of our own. She's going to be speaking on the topic of citizenship, civil rights, and the art of dissent in America. In doing so, she plans on defining each of these, providing a definition of citizenship, a definition of civil rights, and the art of dissent. This promises to be a very insightful lecture, as a matter of fact, and I'm glad to see that the students are here to get a little bit from this, as well as the faculty. It's important, though, that during these events and these lectures, that we pay attention to what's being presented to us by scholars who've been doing research in the field. The field is still very much open. And right now, we're celebrating 50 years of the modern civil rights movement. It might seem like a long time ago to many of you, but it's a very, very short time in history. In fact, I was 8 years old, and 4 years old, and 5 years old, and some of these events are still occurring. And right now, we're still fighting for various groups are fighting for citizenship, for some respect, and using the art of dissent to do so. But at this point, I'd like to ask for Ms. Tanisha Smith to come up and introduce the speaker. Ms. Smith.
Good morning.
Good morning.
When asked to introduce our guest speaker, I jumped at the chance. I was introduced to her 2 years ago as a sophomore, and instantly her passion and zeal spilled over to me. Little did I know how much of an effect she would have on my academic career. So it is with special excitement that I am pleased to welcome Dr. Katherine Bankole-Medina. Dr. Medina wears many hats: author, scholar, research director, and professor. Her research and scholarship is deeply rooted in history and the African world experience, particularly reflecting her expertise in the history of science, medicine, and technology. Her professorship spans over 20 years, lecturing an extensive selection of courses in history and Africana studies, including African American history, African American cultural and intellectual history, Latin American history, the history of science, medicine, and technology, and other special topic courses. She is the author of many scholarly publications, including the groundbreaking text Slavery and Medicine, Enslavement and Medical Practices in Antebellum Louisiana, and You Left Your Mind in Africa. Her most recent publications include The Historical Legacy of the Nadir and Houstonian Jurisprudence in the Origins of the Modern Civil Rights Movement, and Commanding Pestle and Mortar, Research Notes on the Odyssey of Black Women's Studies, History, and Pedagogy. Currently, her article, A Historical Account of Diagnostic Racism and the Southern Typhoid Fever Thesis, which is a working title, is pending peer review. Dr. Medina is the founding editor of the scholarly journal Afrological Perspectives and the blog and YouTube series History is a State of Mind. The recipient of many teaching, research, and service awards, Dr. Medina received the first ever Distinguished Faculty Researcher Award from Coppin State University for her grant proposal encompassing the life and work of Fanny Jackson Coppin, and was recently named a fellow of the Molefe Kete Asante Institute in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Continuing with our theme of celebrating 50 years of civil rights in America, Dr. Medina's Citizenship, Civil Rights, and the Art of Science and Dissent in America, The Bones of the Saints, will promise to enlighten, teach, and inspire. So please join me in welcoming my mentor and Coppin's very own, Dr. Katherine Bankole-Medina.
Thank you very much, Ms. Smith. That is so thoughtful, a very thoughtful introduction, and I do remember meeting you. It seems to me, however, we met much longer than 2 years ago. But of course, I could be wrong about that. I am so pleased to have been asked to do this lecture. When Dr. Martin asked me, I really did not have the time, but I wanted to make the time to do it because it is African American History Month, and that's a tradition that we need to observe. So I was hoping for a much larger audience because the presentation that I planned, I have a small PowerPoint, but it's really an outline. I don't really have to run it. But what I planned is a call and response lecture. But I really don't have enough people to do what I want to do. I needed these seats filled to do it. And so I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and read my presentation, okay? Because I find that when I do my extemporaneous speaking, I get a little too enthusiastic about the subject matter, and I go off into some divergent topics. So I think that the best thing for me to do is to read from my text. So please bear with that. And I've got quite a bit to go through. I wanted to make sure that we shared important information with the students. I often refer to my colleagues as good and gentle, and you are good and gentle. I want to wish you a good morning, and I'm going to go through some of the traditional obligatory remarks that have to be made when you're giving such a speech for African American History Month. It is so important that we gather here to share knowledge, information, and to commemorate the history and culture of people of African descent everywhere, and particularly here in this nation. There are a number of people who strive to make sure that we have an excellent African American History Month, and while I do not know all of the people on the committee here at Coppin, I do wish to thank and acknowledge everyone who assisted in some way. And please understand, I don't know who all those names are on the committee, but I am quite thankful for their work. I do know, however, that among the people who should be thanked and acknowledged include Dr. Larry Martin, professor of history here at Coppin State University. Dr. Martin took quite a bit of time out of his schedule to coordinate these activities when he really did not necessarily, as I said, have the time to do that. And we are so appreciative of it. I also would like to acknowledge, if I may, all of my colleagues in the Department of History and Global Studies, Humanities, including Dean Tacona in the School of Education and Arts and Sciences, President Neufeld, Provost Gregory, and all of the deans and vice presidents, and of course, my intrepid colleagues, the faculty. I want to take a moment to read to you what was written about Dr. Woodson in 1940, more than 20 years after he initiated Negro History Week. The information comes from the American Negro Exposition and in Chicago in 1940. And so I think it's important that we acknowledge Dr. Woodson in this way. Carter G. Woodson, historian. As a scholar, author and founder of the Association for the Study of Negro Life and History, Dr. Woodson deserves a place of honor at the exposition as a chronicler of the achievements of the Negro race. Prior to his efforts, no scientific and organized plan of recording the share of the Negro in the history of America had ever been made. Histories and textbooks were written as though the black man had been a passive and unsharing factor of our civilization. Prepared for his life work by the best education, Harvard, the University of Chicago, the Sorbonne in Paris, the Heidelberg universities could give, Dr. Woodson set to work to bring to light these dark passages of American achievement. As a result of his capable work, more than half a hundred volumes of authentic and important historical records are now available in the libraries of the world. He organized the Associated Publishers to publish the historical writings of colored scholars. He issued pictures of outstanding Negro figures and established the annual celebration of Negro History Week. Now, as you know, Dr. Woodson's Negro History Week has been an observance, which has been extended to African American History Month, an event that is recognized here at CSU, around the nation, and around the world for that matter. It is a serious commemoration of a people whose history is nothing less than epic. Please understand that Black History Month is a nationally recognized observance that operates in conjunction with our obligation to preserve, research, study, and present African history throughout the year. So we owe a debt of gratitude to many, many people, but particularly to Dr. Carter G. Woodson. I want to thank all of the students, my students, who are here today, and I want all of my students to know that I know that you're here. So I know that that's very important for you to know that I know. And when I use the word student today in my presentation, I'm referring to you and me, all of us. And so we are all students at all times and all places. All of us are students. The name of my presentation, Citizenship, Civil Rights, and the Art and Science of Dissent in America, or the Bones of the Saints. In this presentation, I will define terms and concepts which will serve as the heart of the discussion, which in essence is about social transformation. First, however, I want to explain to the students what I mean by Bones of the Saints. First of all, let me repeat again. I want to explain to the students what I mean by Bones of the Saints. The bones of African people, which symbolize our history, are scattered all over the world. We step over old bones every day. We commonly walk where someone else has traveled before us. If we are fortunate, powerful, or wise, the bones of history are remembered. In the effort to divine the future, some of our ancestors threw bones to try to tell us something. But what can the bones tell us? I don't know about you, but bones do not tell me that someone has died. Bones tell me that someone has lived. In his book, Africa in My Bones, A Surgeon's Odyssey into the Spirit World of African Healing by David Coombs, the author recalls the bone readings from the Sangoma of South Africa. The author asked the Sangoma about the struggles in his life and work, and the response he received was, "The bones. They say you should be doing this work. The bones say you should be doing African medicine. Your grandmother's bone is telling you to be initiated. Your ancestors want you back in Africa." Dr. Coombs indicates in his work that he did not initially pay attention to the bone reading. Not until after the sixth reading he received. And he happened to receive the same message from six different Sangomas who did not know one another. I also want to share with you another perspective on bones. In their effort to study the African oral tradition, authors Cloete and Mandazi, in their article, Bury My Bones But Keep My Words, examine the relationship concerning the African oral tradition and modern prose writing. In their work, we have a rich discussion about the legacy of African bones in the revelation of the narrative of, in this case, happens to be divination. Now, we are still speaking of bones, as I also share with you a perspective from anthropology. The authors of the article, Early African Diaspora in Colonial Campeche, Mexico, suggest that they have recovered from a colonial church burial ground remains that are consistent with West African origin. Especially, they found evidence of some of the earliest Africans in the diaspora in Mesoamerica and African presence in Campeche, Mexico, probably during the 16th century. So I have defined the bones as a tool of divination, a function of discourse, and a source of scientific inquiry. And the bones are all of these things. But the bones are history as well. We follow ancient African bones all over the world. My colleagues in the History and Global Studies Department can tell you something about bones. Dr. Martin has studied German and Nazi and foreign policy bones. Dr. Davidson studies Civil War and old military bones. Dr. Neverdun Morton has examined all kinds of bones, including women's bones. Dr. Gardner has studied intellectual bones and the bones of books. And like her peers, she has studied other kinds of black bones. Dr. Reardon studies old bones, as well as where the bones are geographically located. Dr. Lewis Moon studies all of the bones, including the women's bones, and what the bones were dressed in. Our former visiting colleagues, Dr. Diaz-Garayua and Reddy, study geocultural and scientific bones. And Dr. Cargbo studies the African bones in African context. And he travels to archives all over the world in search of our bones. So the bones are our history. They are sacred. They tell us the future. They discourse with us. They are evidence that we were there and that we are now here.